Welcome to Eastertide here at Libertyville Covenant Church. We are so glad that you've decided to join us for worship this week. Once again, we are in the midst of the season of Eastertide, which takes us from Easter to Pentecost and celebrates the resurrection. So we are celebrating still this week. A few bits of information before we dive in. You'll see the ever-present chat bar next to you. We'll be using that through worship. Use that for greeting one another, for prayer requests that we'll be able to pray for during our prayer time. Comments on the sermon are welcome in the chat bar. Heather will be using them during the children's talk today, so we encourage you to keep your devices handy so you can take part in the chat bar as you watch our service today. I want to invite you to a couple other opportunities. If you look on our website, www.libcov.org, you will find there a link to our virtual small groups. We'd love to have you join us and be part of one of our small groups in the next few months. So if you want to go there, if you're part of our LCC community, you also will have gotten an email in the last few days that will remind you about that. But we encourage you to sign up for a small group and continue to connect as the body of Christ while we are all sheltering at home. Also, you should be receiving emails throughout the week of different opportunities to serve. We encourage you to take part in those as well. Call another family and see if maybe the two families can serve at the same time so you can at least see one another, even if we can't be all that close. This week, we're beginning our post-Easter sermon series. Last week, we talked about Peter and the resurrection, so we're going to be looking at his letter, 1 Peter, for the next 5 weeks. So we hope that you'll continue to tune in, continue to join us as we together worship God and look together at this amazing letter of discipleship. We're going to move on to our call to worship, so I invite Pastor Paul to come on up.
I'd like to invite you, as you're able, to join me in our call to worship as we begin our worship service together. Let us read together. From different homes, in different states, on different screens, come and seek God in these troubled times. God is with you this very minute. So come and worship. Come and worship. Worship Christ, the newly resurrected King. Let us pray together. Lord, we are reminded that Jesus died. He was buried and on the third day rose. Thank you, God, for hope when hope was lost and for life when death had won. In these pandemic days when so many are suffering, resurrect within our world the faith and hope and love we need to survive. In Eastertide, accept our humble hosannas, which are linked with our deepest prayers for relief from this virus. Healer of every ill, we need you now. With Christians around the world and angels in heaven, we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Amen. Let us share the peace of Christ with such great joy in Eastertide. Let us share these words with one another, not only in the chat bar, but if there's folks in the room with you, let us share that wonderful, blessed greeting. The peace of Christ be with you.
As we come to sing worship to our Lord, we need to remember that everyone is welcome. But the gospel is especially significant for those who are broken, those who are hurting, those who are afraid, those who feel hopeless. And that's what our first song is about. It's called Invitation Fountain. But the most important thing that we can remember about that is that it leads us into our next song, which is You Never Let Go. And I encourage you to pay attention to the words of that one, especially during this time.
Who are we? valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear?
Talk about a word called imitation today in our chat bar. If you wouldn't mind listing what you know about Jesus, what he does, who he is, what his character is like. And while you're doing that, I don't know about you, but during this time, we've been doing a lot of baking at the Larson house. And yesterday, Isaac and I actually made some chocolate chip cookies with M&Ms, some of our favorite things to do, and eat the cookie dough, of course, in the meantime. But one of the ingredients is for vanilla extract. Well, you know what? I didn't have pure vanilla extract. I just had imitation vanilla extract. That's all that I had, imitation vanilla extract. Now, the cool thing about imitation vanilla extract, it is still vanilla extract, but it's a copy of pure vanilla extract. And so it still works. So we still had some yummy chocolate chip cookies. Today, that's one of the words that we're going to be talking about is the word imitation or to imitate. So I want you to think about some things that are imitations or copies of. I know when I was younger, my younger brother, he liked to copycat me and it would drive me absolutely crazy. And we're going to do something with that here in a minute. But before we do that, one thing that's an imitation is a mirror. If I were to take a mirror and use it to look at myself, oh, look. Hey, Scott. Thanks, Scott, for all you do. All right, here is an imitation, a copy of me and Scott there in the background. That's one imitation. Some of you may like to take selfies on your phone. That's another type of imitation or copy of yourself in that moment. Maybe you want to do that right now. But I also want us to do an exercise. I mentioned copycatting earlier. And so I've asked Pastor Paul to come over. And he is going to copycat me. All right? He's going to be the imitation of me. Now, granted, yes, he's a different height and we don't have the exact same clothes on. But he is going to copy me. So what I'd like you to do right now is actually find somebody else at home to copy you. And set that up. So I'm going to give you a second or two to find somebody, and I want you to be standing in front of each other. All right. Now I want you just to take a few seconds, and you are going to move, and the person that you chose to copycat you is going to try to do the exact same thing that you're doing. Let's see how well Paul and I do. And if you want to do this at the same time, notice he's already tried to copy me. You may do so. So take a few seconds and see how well your copycat does copying you. All right, how did it go? This is something you could be doing all week. You're bored? Why not find a copycat? Something you can do. I mean, you know, sometimes we need to practice a little bit of that. Thank you, Pastor Paul. He could have kept going. That would have been kind of fun. But anyhow, the reason why we bring this up about copycatting or imitating or being an imitation is because today we're going to be talking about how to be like Christ. As Christians, that's what we're called to do. We're called to imitate him, to be like Jesus. And so, yes, I asked you at the beginning of this time to list some things that you knew about Jesus, what he does, who he is, what his character is like. Now I want you to think in that chat bar is to share how you can imitate and be like Jesus. So whether you're a big kid or a little kid, I want you to take a moment during this time as we kind of transition to some other things and chat right in some ways that you can imitate and be like Jesus. And this week, I want you to do it.
Thank you, Heather, for that invitation, and what a good lesson to learn and apply. I'd like to invite us now to pray together as you are where you are and to bring your prayers before God. Like we've said before, that might be something you want to make known in the chat bar for folks to be praying with you and for your particular prayer request, and I hope to be praying with and for you as well. Let's just take a moment to come before God in prayer. Holy God, who in great love has bonded us to yourself and the selfless choice of offering up your Son, Jesus, in our world, accept our praise for every time and every place we find him risen and reigning among us. For every time we resist the seduction of power's many faces, every way we recognize surprises of grace, where and when we had no hope nor courage, we unashamedly credit our companion Jesus, having taken room in our hearts. All this inspires our thanksgiving, Lord. Lord, for the things that many take for granted, for the air that we breathe, for the food that we've eaten, for the reasonable comforts and fresh daily gifts of spiritual miracles that keep us going when so much around us threatens to perpetuate anxiety and despair. God, we know you're present amid the challenges we face regarding this illness we call COVID-19. Might you remind us that you're still on the throne and still remind us that you walk with us and guide us beside still waters to restore our souls even now in this time that are fragile. God, we have to experience so much loss today. We're mindful of those that have lost jobs and are struggling to know what tomorrow will bring. We recognize the many college students that have been sent home, that their education's transitioning from on-campus living to being online. Graduations canceled and celebrations of life that has long been prepared. God, we just lift those losses to you. Lord, for the hearts that break, Lord, we just ask you continue to mend that. Lord, we recognize that there are many people around the world that are struggling with not only just this illness, but many others. For those losses, Lord, for those that are in pain, for those that are crying out for you, God, might you hear our prayer. Lord, we pray that you continue to give courage and uphold those that are continually risking their lives, laying down their lives to love their neighbors. Lord, won't you help bring about healing and wholeness? Lord, you are our great physician. God, we know that we can come to you even with something as heavy as this. Lord, that you might turn this into something beautiful. God, we know that you're present, encouraging those who are suffering wounds that have been seen and are unseen. We pray for those suffering violence and abuse in their homes. We pray for those wondering what will tomorrow bring. Lord, that if you're near, God, we yearn for the opportunity to gather with loved ones and friends and just remember again what a hug feels like. Lord, we pray that you will help us be restored in community. But until that day comes, Lord, might we be enlivened and reminded of your presence. God, we give thanks. God, we give great thanks for your willingness to die for us. Keenly aware, Lord, you understand suffering as you died on the cross. We are redeemed by a wounded Savior. We are held by one who loves and understands like no other. God, we give thanks that we are known and saved by grace you extend. We pray together this morning, seeking to be known and heard by you. And we pause now, lifting up our prayers in our homes. Lord, that you hear them. Lord, hear our prayers this morning. Lord, and with those prayers, and a prayer that you had taught your disciples to pray, we join our voices together praying. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Scott and Luke. As we were reminded that God has given us such rich and wonderful blessings, that God has entrusted us to steward these gifts well, whether it's playing an instrument for the Lord, using all that God has blessed you with in your life, that we might offer that up as a blessing and as a way of giving thanks. This morning, during our offering time, you'll notice on a screen on the internet, you'll see that libcov.org is our website, and we invite you to wonder about and to ask yourself, what might God be inviting you to do this morning in terms of what might you give? Not only of yourself to loving your neighbors or non-for-profits, but what might God be inviting you to further the kingdom? Once you consider giving and remaining faithful in our giving as God so leads. God has blessed us so mightily, and we give thanks. As we give thanks, why don't we gather together and lifting our voices, singing the doxology together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you have not spared your own Son, but delivered him up for all of us. And you have freely given us all things in him. Receive these offerings which we bring and dedicate to you. Enable us with all our gifts, so to yield ourselves to you, that with body, soul, and spirit, we may truly and freely serve you, and in your service find our deepest joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us continue in our singing together. Let us sing hymn 243, Thine is the Glory.
Thank you. Our first scripture reading comes from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 8, verses 1 through 6, and verses 15 through 19. Be careful to follow every command I am giving you today, so that you may live and increase and may enter and possess the land the Lord promised on oath to your ancestors. Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the wilderness these 40 years to humble and test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you could keep his commands. He humbled you, causing you to hunger, and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your ancestors had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothes did not wear out, and your feet did not swell during these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as man disciplines his son, so the Lord your God disciplines you. Observe the commands of the Lord your God, walking in obedience to him and revering him. He led you through the vast and dreadful wilderness, that thirsty and waterless land with its venomous snakes and scorpions. He brought you water out of hard rock. He gave you manna to eat in the wilderness, something your ancestors had never known, to humble and test you, so that in the end it might go well with you. You may say to yourself, "My power and the strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me." But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms his covenant, which he swore to your ancestors, as it is today. If you ever forget the Lord your God and follow other gods and worship and bow down to them, I testify against you today that you will surely be destroyed. Our second scripture reading comes from the book of 1 Peter, chapter 1, verses 15 through 22. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, "Be holy because I am holy." Since you call on a Father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and hope are in God. Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for each other, love one another deeply from the heart. This is the word of the Lord.
As many people know that go to our church, I'm a bit of a sucker for a superhero movie. I've seen a lot of them, if not most of them. One that I particularly enjoyed was Aquaman. I really liked the way that they took kind of the expectations of what we had going into it and flipped them a little bit on their heads. Aquaman, Arthur Curry, sets somewhat the stereotype of fishermen in a particular scene. They're sitting in a bar, and Arthur Curry is sitting at the bar drinking, and in walks a group of big, burly fishermen. These guys are what we'd expect from fishermen. They're big and they're loud and they're tough. They come off as uneducated. And so this is what people have come to expect from fishermen. They come up to Arthur Curry, who is Aquaman, and, well, let's just say that no brawl ensues. In fact, it's a pretty funny flip of the stereotype. I encourage you to see it if you haven't seen it yet before. But if you think about fishermen, hip deep, working in dead fish, hauling nets and lines day after day, weathering the storms that come. But more than that, I mean, that would make you strong and big and loud, but they're also forced to trust one another with their lives and with their livelihoods. They're kind of like farmers, and while many of us probably don't know professional fishermen, we know sport fishermen, but not professional fishermen, we may well know some farmers. And like farmers, fishermen are dependent on the uncontrollable aspects of nature for their food. I would guess this gives fishermen a deep, deep connection to their co-workers and their friends and a deep trust in God. Pete Johnson is this to a T. Pete Johnson is actually the Apostle Peter. His name is Peter, son of John, so we're just going to call him Pete Johnson for today. But we walked last week the journey that Peter took of the resurrection. I encourage you to take a look below if you didn't see it from last week, and that'll kind of lead us into this week. Peter was big and loud and tough and uneducated, but with a deep, almost innocent trust of Jesus. Peter is famous for speaking before he thinks, for charging ahead into any situation, for acting rashly, but also for a deep, deep loyalty and love for Jesus and his fellow disciples. After the events of the book of Acts, including his sermon at Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, including his leadership position within the global church at that time, including the vision that he had about cleanness that God gave to him, and then his introduction of the Gentiles into the church in Acts 10, and of course his very public argument with the Apostle Paul in Acts 15. After all this, we believe that Peter went on and moved to Rome. There he became the leader of the church and also the writer of two of our New Testament books, which bear his name. 1 and 2 Peter are pastoral books written by a big, loud, tough, uneducated, one-time fisherman, now turned pastor and leader. And they're full of the wisdom of someone who walked close beside Jesus during his ministry here. Someone who was trained personally by Jesus. Someone who loved Jesus deeply. So as we are closing out our year of discipleship, which began in the fall and continues on till Memorial Day, we're going to dive deeply into 1 Peter together. We're going to learn from this fisherman, this head of the apostles, this leader of the church. So I want to encourage you to grab your Bibles. We're going to be in them, and we're not going to be just looking at the text that was read today, but rather the entire first chapter, so you'll need them. So whether that means that you bring it up on your computer or turn in your Bible to it, I really want to encourage you to have 1 Peter 1 open. And as you're doing that, I'm going to ask, please take a moment and pray that God's Holy Spirit might speak to us today. Let's pray together. Lord God, speak. Speak through your word. Speak through your spirit. Lord God, help us to know you more, to trust you more, and to learn from Peter, the fisherman. In your name we pray. Amen. Grace and peace to you in abundance. Peter begins his letter. Grace from the man who betrayed Jesus and then was forgiven and restored. Peace from the man who cut off Malchus's ear when they were arresting Jesus in the garden. This blessing from Peter goes out to his people who are scattered throughout the known world. Peter's readers were former Gentiles who learned about God and so attached themselves to the local synagogue. But then when Christians came and told them of Jesus Christ, the Messiah they'd been waiting for, they moved on and attached themselves to this collection, this small church of Christians. As they did this, they learned about Jesus. And as they did this, before Christianity became cool in the world, you might say, they were facing some pretty deep persecution for joining this church. Like Daniel in the Old Testament and Revelation in the New Testament, 1 Peter is a book written about endurance in the midst of persecution. But more than that, this book is about how the faithful should deal with the world around us. How should we as the church interact with the world, the society around us? I want to take a quick aside. Scott McKnight has listed in his commentary on this three different ways the church has historically attempted to deal with society around it. The first is called separatism. In this way of dealing with the world, the church runs away from it. It draws itself in. It becomes different. It becomes holy, and it becomes quite proud of that. The church is separate from the state and takes no part in it. We see this in groups like the Amish and the Anabaptists and the Mennonites. So the first is separatism. The second is extension, expanding Christianity into the secular culture. If it's God's call for an individual in Scripture, they say, then it must be God's call for the whole of society. Christian political action based on individual ethics is the means of this group, the extension group. The third is called the two realms thought, which is that God and his people have a different ethic than God and society and the world around us. God has different expectations for his church and for the world at large. We can't expect secular society to live by Christian personal ethics, but rather by a societal ethic instead. These are three different ways historically the church has attempted to deal with the world around it. But for Peter, the question is, how should Christians live in relation to the Roman-led government? Remember, Rome was in power during this time. And I believe since there are a ton of parallels between the American Empire of today and the Roman Empire of Peter's day, that this book is deeply relevant to us. The church is not part of the world society, so how does the church relate to it? Peter uses two words to describe his people that I think speak to this. He uses the word foreigners. That's people who are living here but don't have the legal protection or the rights as citizens. And then he also uses the word strangers, people living here only a short time before heading home. Think about those two words of foreigner and stranger in relationship to the church. And we can begin to see what Peter is going to be telling us about how the church relates to society at large. How then shall we live, we ask Peter. How do we then reside in American society as obedient Christians? Let's take a look at Peter's book. We're going to skip the first two verses. We looked at those a little bit. Let's read on from verse 3. And let me read Peter's first sentence that comes after his greeting. His sentence is this: Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in his great mercy has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into the inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, for this inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. And in all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief of all kinds and all kinds of trials, but these have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, or of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though it's refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Halfway done. For though you have not seen him, you love him, and even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with the inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls, and concerning this salvation, the prophets who spoke of the grace that was to come to you searched intently with the greatest care, trying to find out the time and circumstances to which the Spirit in Christ in them was pointing when he predicted the sufferings of the Messiah and the glories that would follow, and it is revealed to them that they were not serving themselves but you when they spoke of the things that have now been told you by those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, for even angels long to look into these things. Period. I thought Paul was the one who always had long run-on sentences, but Peter does it too. That entire chunk is one sentence, but there's a reason for it. This one long sentence covers a whole lot of ground, but all of it and the entire rest of this letter will lead back to this one thought. Salvation is what it's all about. Not finding salvation, not earning salvation, not getting to salvation, but because we are saved through the blood of Jesus Christ, all the rest of the letter follows. We're going to be talking a lot about ethics in the next 5 weeks. But these ethics all are a response to our salvation, not a means to it. Salvation, Peter understands better than most, is free. It's a gift to be received and acted upon. We are saved because of God's mercy and his love for us. We are good in response to that salvation. Our confirmands are currently studying the Reformation, and this is one of Luther's key points. Salvation isn't earned. It's a free gift of God that then makes us holy, ethical people. Look at verse 13. It starts with one word, therefore. Now, I hope my Wednesday night Bible study group, I hope your ears are ringing as you listen to this. We've been talking about this for a couple of years in there. Whenever you see the word therefore, you have to ask what it's there for. My youth pastor taught me that back in high school, and I still use it today. When we see the word therefore, we have to look back and say, therefore what? Therefore, in light of all that's come before, and all that's come before is God's salvation poured out into our lives. Because of salvation, what does Peter say to us here? In light of our salvation, with minds in the translation, there's really interesting, with minds ready to work. It's the idea of girding your loins, which you can look up and figure out what that means. But for us today, that would mean rolling your sleeves up, getting ready to get to work. So with minds ready to get to work and fully self-controlled, which means not controlled by other things. What are some of the things in this world that control us? Take a second, put some in the chat bar. What are some things in this world that control us? There's a lot. You could probably come up with a whole bunch of them yourself. Things that control us should not control us. We should be only controlled by one thing, and that's us humbly submitting ourselves to the Holy Spirit. So, with our minds ready for some good hard work and in complete control of our bodies, he says, be holy. Be holy. Be good. Be godly. Live by God's ethics. But why? Why should we be good? If we've already got salvation, then why should we be good? If good works doesn't earn us a place in heaven, why be good in the first place? We've always been told since we were little kids to behave, to be good, to obey. But as we got into our teen years, we began asking, why? In the Old Testament, which we read earlier, we see one way that you can get people to be good. In the Old Testament, those two mountains, Mount Ebal and Mount Gerizim, one was called the Mount of Curses, and one was called the Mount of Blessings. And what they did is they stood there and chanted. The whole people read out what was read for us earlier in our scripture. If you follow God's rules, you'll be blessed in this, and you'll be blessed in this, and this will be blessed, and this will be best. And if you do not follow God, then this will be cursed, and this will be cursed, and this will be cursed. Reward and punishment is a pretty common way that we try to create behaviors in people. It's how we control kids' behaviors, to be completely honest, because more immature minds need these kinds of rewards and punishments. What about Jesus? Why did Jesus say we should be good? Jesus said, be good because that's what it means to follow me. It's your choice. You can be holy and follow me because that's what that means. Or be worldly and don't follow me. How about for Paul, the lawyer? The Apostle Paul says, we should be good because God said so in scriptures. Fits that a lawyer would go back to the book, would go back to scriptures. If you are still here, he says, then you must be wanting to follow the scriptures. So Paul goes on and tells us what that looks like. How do we be good? But for today, we're looking at Peter. Why does Peter say we should be good? What is Peter's main reason? He says, be holy because, look in your text, be holy because I am holy, says the Lord. Disciples follow their master. We've talked a lot about what happens when a disciple is called by their rabbi, but let's just suffice it to say that disciples go up through schooling and most of them leave and go learn a trade. But when a rabbi comes and says, follow me, and someone becomes a disciple of their rabbi, when Peter comes and follows Jesus, The statement is that we hope that a disciple is covered in the dust of their rabbi because they're following them that close. A disciple of anyone else is trying to imitate them, as Heather said earlier today. They're trying to be just like them in what they say and what they do. Some went so far in what they ate, in where they slept. In all of these aspects, we want to be exactly like the one we're following. That's what it means to be a disciple. Why should we be good? Why should we be holy? Be holy because Jesus was holy. Jesus was good, and so therefore his disciples need to be good as well if we're following him. For Peter, it's not about behavior management. For Peter, it's about how best to imitate Jesus. The rest of this book, as we talk about ethics, is going to lead back to this again. How can we best imitate Jesus? Now, what does that mean? He gives us a hint at what we're going to talk about. What does it mean for us to be holy? What does it mean for us to be like Jesus? What does it mean for us to be good in a Christian sense, which is different than being good in a societal sense? Verse 22 makes it very clear. Love each other. Oh, that again? Don't we always wind up at love each other? Isn't that what the church is constantly saying? How many times have we heard this? Love one another. It's one of the biggest cliches that we hear again and again and again. But it was one of, if not the primary teaching Peter heard from Jesus as he walked with him for 3.5 years. Love one another. This isn't, though, just a nicey-nice attitude of not being mean to people as you go about living your life for yourself. And Peter wants to do that, so he qualifies this. He doesn't just say love each other. He says love each other from the heart. Love each other from the heart. Paul wanted to transform behavior by renewing our minds. Peter wants us to imitate Jesus by renewing our hearts. This is not a love that comes out of duty. This is not a love that comes from obedience. In ancient thought that still holds over for today, the mind was the place for logic and reason and intellect. The belly was the place for appetites and lusts and urges. But the heart was the place for courage and loyalty and emotion. Peter says, because you have received this free gift of salvation, because you want to imitate Jesus in your every thought and word and action, love each other from your heart, with emotion, with loyalty, with courage. If you are following Jesus Christ, then the first thing you need to do in life is imitate Christ. Think and talk and act like Jesus in every way you possibly can in every moment. That means that you will be holy because Jesus was holy and you're imitating him. And that means that you'll work with your sleeves rolled up at loving others from the heart. Everything else, from our relationships to our jobs, to our bank accounts, to our free time, to our families, should be about helping us to love others with emotion, with loyalty, and with courage. Peter has a lot more to say about how we should behave as holy disciples following in the footsteps of our rabbi Jesus. But all of it will flow out of our salvation, this free gift that God offers every one of us. And it will all be about imitating Jesus Christ. Would you pray with me? God, our Heavenly Father, we want to follow you, but it's hard. Lord God, we want to follow you, and thankfully you have shown us how to do that. Lord, we want to follow you, and so help us in every moment, in this very moment, and for the rest of this day, help us to figure out new ways to imitate you, to talk like you and think like you and look at the world the way you did, and most of all, to interact with other people the way you did. Lord, help us to love from our hearts. In the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen. I encourage you to take a little time to reflect on that today. That's not something that just sits there and you go, oh, okay, and move on. This is something you need to think about. So take some time. If you're not watching this live, maybe this is a good time to just pause and spend 5 minutes in reflection thinking about what this means for you. If you are watching it live, I encourage you to take some time after the service. Maybe with the group you're watching with, take 5-10 minutes and just have a conversation. What does that look like for us to imitate Jesus in this world? But as we close, and as we continue to reflect on this theme, we're going to close with the hymn 412, Be Thou My Vision. Let's sing together. Once again, I want to encourage you to join us next Sunday, again at 10:30, for our worship service and also a continuing look at this book of 1 Peter. I want to encourage you again to look in our webpage and join one of our virtual small groups. We would love to see you getting together on a regular basis just to talk about Christianity in the midst of this culture, to look at a book, to study the Bible, to pray together, or just to have some good fellowship. So join us in our virtual small groups. And now, as you go from this place, go as imitators of Jesus Christ. Go as people who are loving others from their heart, with all that that means. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.